Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, dear colleagues, welcome to Lithuania, welcome to Presidential Palace. It is an honor for me to open our international conference, Vilnius Democracy Forum. The beginning of the 21st century was not the end of history with the global domination of a liberal democracy, as some scholars predicted. Far from it. The number of authoritarian states are on the rise, while in many hybrid states, red lines between democracy and authoritarian regime are blurring. New types of non-democratic political models are now challenging the concept of Western democracy. This is the reason why the empiric and theoretic analysis of non-democratic regimes is gaining increasing importance. Russia's political system requires new definitions and methods of analysis. Kremlin's regime is often seen as a black box in which various interest groups and clans compete with one another for resources and power. Collective Putin, or a new version of Politburo, these are the names given to the Russian political system by many experts. Putin acts as a moderator with the right of a final say, because without him, this kleptocratic system would fail. Russian political system is very sensitive to internal challenges, especially growing competition between the elite groups and redrawing the zones of influence. The main aim of this conference is to try to get at least a glimpse into that black box and discuss how it really works, what are its strengths and weaknesses, what kind of strategy should be chosen by the transatlantic community, how to deal with this non-democratic regime. I am delighted that here in Vilnius we have the best experts from both sides of Atlantic, at least to try to answer these complex questions. Many thanks goes to the authors of the idea to organize this conference, the Hudson Institute. I also would like to thank all other co-organizers, the Konrad Adenauer Stiftung, National Endowment for Democracy, Freedom House, and the Institute of International Relations and Political Science at Vilnius University. The forum will be live-streamed via our media partner, Delphi. We hope that Vilnius Democracy Forum will become a traditional annual platform which will regularly open up an opportunity to meet and discuss trends in international relations. Finally, I would like to express our gratitude to Her Excellency, President of the Republic of Lithuania, Dalia Grybauskaitė, for hosting us here in the Presidential Palace. And I would like to invite Foreign Policy Chief Advisor to the President, Renaldas Weisbrodas, to present a presidential message for our conference.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it is a pleasure to host Vilnius Democracy Forum. Today, Europe is experiencing the biggest human tide since the end of the Second World War. Solidarity and responsibility are the key words of this crisis. Our solidarity is with those fleeing war, conflict, and prosecution. Our responsibility is to protect external borders, implement the rules guarding Schengen, and ensure the security of our citizens. Wars and conflict do not happen overnight. They are bred by those that have no value for human life, those that put survival of the few above the good of the many. Ukraine is high on our minds in Lithuania. The Ukrainians are fighting and dying for the soul of Europe. They are proving to the world that the will of the free people of Ukraine will not be subservient to the size of the military of a neighbor. And in this, we have full solidarity and responsibility to stand with Ukraine. Tomorrow, we are going to celebrate together the International Day of Democracy. The angle of your discussion is an extremely pertinent one. The non-democratic regimes are feeding on fear and crime. They spread war, oppression, and despair. The stability and legitimacy of the reign depends on the unlimited supply of resources in the pockets of the few. Therefore, it is the prerogative of democracies to speak the truth and to stand in solidarity with the people. State-sponsored corruption kills freedom. Resources need to reform or modernize are diverted to serve one goal: ensure the preservation of the leader and the elites. This is a true tragedy. It is our responsibility to follow the trail of breadcrumbs left by those involved in crime, corruption and money laundering, and take action to prevent this happening on our watch. The European Union in this regard can and should do more. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to thank you for gathering here in Vilnius for this important event, and I wish you every success for your discussion. President of the Republic of Lithuania, Dalia Grybauskaitė.
Thank you, Renaldas. I'm quite sure what you all are familiar with a distinguished expert of Russian political system who soon will come here and start our main part of the conference. According to the New York Times, her latest book, Putin's Kleptocracy, Who Owns Russia, is the most persuasive account what we have of corruption in contemporary Russia. Wall Street Journal adds that it is an important and valuable work because it provides the most comprehensive investigation into the patterns of Russian government corruption. The concept of kleptocratic regimes offers not only new insights into the Russia, but also it is a framework on how to empirically and theoretically analyze our non-democratic regimes. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to invite Karen Davisha, Professor of Political Science at Miami University, to make the keynote address, please.
Councillor Vice Barodis, Director Katz, Junius, Ambassador Pavilionis, and all of the wonderful Lithuanian team, thank you so much for everything you've done to make this wonderful conference happen. And also thank you to the members of the CIMIS and the Diplomatic Corps who are here, and dear colleagues. I also particularly want to thank Charles Davidson for his real foresight in establishing the Kleptocracy Initiative at Hudson and for bringing together the American team. You know, it's my first visit, I really am sorry to say, to Lithuania. But I've long known about Lithuania. I wrote a book called Eastern Europe, Gorbachev and Reform, and I wrote another book on the collapse of the Soviet Union. And always there was the first paragraph would be, and then something happened in Lithuania. And yesterday it was really an enormous moment for me to visit the Museum of the Genocide and to go to the parliament and to see the barricades there and to feel the importance for you of talking about what's happening in Chechnya, the plaque that is on the parliament building. Horrible things there have been done there from the very beginning of this regime that we have in Russia. Well, I would like to say, to start, that what we had hoped for, Russia, has not come to pass. While you were building civil society, democracy, and market economies here, in Russia, the mafia, oligarchs and the KGB started to work side by side in the ruins of a collapsed economy. While we, all of us, were dreaming of democracy also taking hold in Russia and joined with and encouraged civil society, the rule of law, and independent political parties there, those men who had grown up in the shadows and in the corridors of the KGB, sought to control these developments, to control Russia's immense wealth for themselves and for the members of the new nobility there. Amongst them was a man called Vladimir Putin. He was amongst them first as a member and of course now as a new czar. It was clear to Western intelligence before 2000 that Putin and his cronies had been stealing from the very beginning. The West had this intelligence, and on the basis of it, Russia was placed on the international money laundering watch list because of their information about Putin in 2000. But then, Gerhard Schroeder was elected, Tony Blair was elected, and George Bush was elected, and the war on terror took up all of their time. And Putin quickly joined that war as an ally, and no one wanted to bring up these nasty little facts. It was not until 2012, when the reset was in tatters, and Putin came back as president, using riot police to suppress free demonstrators, peaceful demonstrators in Bolotnaya, protesting against the stealing of the 2011 Duma election, that US and West European leaders had to face up to the essential truth of what Russian opposition and East European researchers and public had long since known, that this is a cynical and cruel dictatorship bent on subverting Western institutions globally and effectively undermining sovereignty of post-Soviet states locally. Today, while think tanks in Germany, France, the UK, and the United States call for realism in dealing with Russia, and sagely remind policymakers in Washington and elsewhere of the impossibility for the United States or anyone else of matching Russia's invested interest in Ukraine, and shake their heads at the impossibility of dealing with Ukraine's legendary problems with corruption, no one seems to stop to reflect on what is the natural foreign policy of a kleptocratic regime, except the export of corruption. And the control and subversion of states through that corruption. When we look at the problems that Ukraine is going through, yes, some of them may be homegrown, but many of them have a Russian trail. In an era of globalization, tariffs are removed, but so too are sovereign protections. And when states use criminal enterprises to launder, counterfeit, and profiteer, both off of their own people and off of the willingness of certain elites in the West to join in the bacchanalia, we have to admit that we have a problem. In 1975, Vladimir Putin joined the KGB. In the same year, the Helsinki Final Acts were signed. His first assignment, the lessons that he learned at Red Banner School 101 in Moscow, was how to implement Operation Raskol. Operation Raskol, or schism in English, was the actual, as opposed to the stated, Soviet response to Helsinki. And we know these from the Mitrokhin archives. We have the documents. This plan included the discrediting of Sakharov and Solzhenitsyn, driving a wedge between the United States and Europe, and convincing the US that detente could succeed without giving Europe and Eastern Europe its natural right to rejoin those in the West. This operation is how Vladimir Putin was trained. This is who he is. And if we don't think that there isn't a Raskol-2, another operation now in operation, we are very foolish. Today, this operation includes encouraging the West to forget Politkovskaya, Nemtsov, Starovoitova, to split the US from Europe, to drive wedges within West European countries by supporting certain political parties, and to make Ukraine fail, and to weaken the sovereignty of the Baltic states and NATO commitment to them. We can't afford to allow Operation Raskol-2 to succeed, and I hope this conference will begin to forge unity amongst the expert and policy community on ways to deal with kleptocratic Russia. US and Lithuanian experts prior to this meeting have drafted a declaration of principles which will be released formally tomorrow, but will be referred to, I think, in many people's presentations. We call on other citizens, civil society, and governments 40 years after Helsinki to confirm the right of people to live in freedom, to safeguard sovereignty of states, to promote respect for human rights, to support free journalism, to strengthen resistance to kleptocracies, to reinforce the right of states to choose their geopolitical allies, to reaffirm the security commitments of NATO member states, and to refuse to recognize territorial claims made in violation of international law. No one, certainly not me, seeks anything but honest engagement with Russia and its people. But neither should we accept Putin's new Game of Thrones, which threatens to return all of us to an era of spooks and shadows. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam, for your impressive introduction. And now I would like to give the floor for Elizabeth Bauer, representative of Konrad Adenauer Stiftung, offices in Baltic States and for Scandinavia. Please, Elizabeth.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, as a representative of the CAS in the Baltic States, I am proud to be part of the organizer of this conference. Especially out of our history, democracy is meant very special was something for us as being political, as being in the political sphere, in the political education. So, and we are over here by now, 22 years, so we can see a lot of development over here. Coming to today, Europe now faces enormous amount of challenges, including refugee crisis, geopolitical issues, and financial uncertainty. Yet the core values remain unchanged. Democracy, rule of law, and freedom of speech are the basics which allowed Europe to become the most prosperous region in the world. Yet, not all the countries around the globe share the same perception. Growing number of states restrict their citizens' freedom and democracy. Clans of elite are taking over the control and not allowing others to have their state. It leads to a slower development, growing gap between rich and poor, and global security challenges. Hence, it is our duty to take the responsibility and help those in need. We as the Konrad Adenauer Foundation are supporting developing states all around the world. Our offices abroad are in charge of over 200 projects in more than 120 countries. Because we focus on consolidating democracy, the unification of Europe and the strengthening of transatlantic relations. Here in Lithuania, we are already working for more than two decades and see the rapid development. Now Lithuania is leading a family of countries which are eager to help others. And for me, as I am a historian, I see really a little bit of coming history again, because the reason why Germany are the way working as we are doing was the same way, because we had a lot of help after the Second World War developing our democracy, and so we are doing the same over here, especially regarding the Eastern Neighborhood Partnership. This conference, I'm sure, will act as a great platform to unite leading experts from Eastern and Western Europe, as well as the United States, and discuss how to strengthen democracy around the globe. I am now more than happy to invite Her Excellency Tenetin Kidashevli, Defense Minister of Georgia, to make a speech and present perception of one of the most important regions in Europe. Sorry, my pronunciation probably was wrong. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, and thank you to the organizers of this conference for giving me this opportunity to talk to you today and to present the vision from Georgia. Actually, I should say that it is very difficult for me to speak after the presentation we have just heard, because there is not that much left to be said, and I can just simply subscribe to every word that that you've been saying here about today's Russia and about the threats and challenges that we are all facing. And I believe that when you were mentioning Ukraine, you meant Georgia as well, because that's exactly where we missed it all, or missed it all, we can say it both ways. In 2008, when August war did not serve as a wake-up call good enough for the entire world community to be alerted and to know what was coming and what was happening in Georgia. Some people found themselves in a very comfortable pose at that time, blaming on the president of Georgia most of it, and saying that he was hot-headed, and we've heard lots of other words used for characterizing the policies of the government of Georgia at that time. But unfortunately, it took Ukraine and the war in Ukraine for everybody to understand that Russia does not need excuses. Russia does not need to be provoked. Russia today is not kind of a state which is looking at the developments, analyzing, making conclusions out of it, and is interested in the world affairs or world politics or the current modern international law setup for that matter. It's a country that has a very clear vision, very clear agenda. It has a president who has a very well developed, very well spoken on so many different speeches, action plan by which it is proceeding. It's just we sometimes miss to hear, to listen, to understand what is it that he is talking about, or what is it that they are working for or acting against. Georgia 2008 was the best manifestation of the brutality one can expect from a state. It was not just a war itself. It was not just a war as it happened right after the Bucharest summit, telling to the whole world that that was a response to non-deliverable NATO. But everything what happened right after the official end of the war was the best manifestation of the kind of brutality we can see from a country that was fighting Georgia that war. The war officially was over on 11th of August or 12th of August, you can say, take both dates for it. And then for 3 months, up to November 2012, the Georgian villages were physically, literally speaking, bulldozed one after another in South Ossetia. Every single house there was physically bulldozed and erased from the earth. And for not allowing any Georgian to ever even think about returning back to their homes of residence, as those villages simply did not exist after the August war. And they've installed a physically installed a big Russian military base instead of the Georgian villages in South Ossetia. Unfortunately, it took just a couple of months to the world to be angry on Russia, and then after the New Year's, everything was back to business as usual. We had a reset policy and lots of other developments around the world between Russia and the rest of the world. Which is fine, we are okay with having Russia as a partner if it ever works. The problem is that that's not kind of a country you can expect an honest and reliable partnership from. And I think once again Ukraine has proved that we were right. And we hate saying that we were right in 2009 when we were telling to the world, don't get it back to business as usual. Don't have them back to all formats, all tables as partners. Because the partnership, as Russia understands it, if you go from the wars and actual conflicts and fights for a second, and just talk about the rest of the partnership Russia is involved with the Western world and with the Western Europe. The way they understand it, for example, when it comes to providing energy to Western Europe, is that every time somebody makes a strong statement, the partnership understood by Russia is blackmailing with the security and with the energy security and resources. This is kind of partnership we can expect from Russia. And today, every time that we hear that because of Syria, because of the refugee crisis, because of ISIS, because of all the troubles the world is facing, you might start rethinking the policy Western European nations and the United States have towards Russia, or NATO and European Union have towards Russia. It scares us. It should be the same way scaring for everybody, I would say, especially in the part of the world that we are today, but it particularly and definitely scares Georgians. Because we know how these messages are translated in Moscow. I forgot the name of the capital. We know how they understand it. We know how they feel after those statements. We know what will be the action from Moscow after every single statement of that kind. In 2009, we said, because Russia got away with Georgia, Ukraine is next. And I remember people making fun of us when we were leaving the rooms. Nobody believed in it. Everybody was making an argument in every forum against us, saying that, well, Ukraine is in the middle of Europe. It's too big for Russia to swallow. We understand the fears of Georgians, but it's a completely different setup. It's a completely different world today. And unfortunately, it happened. And now we tell to the world that if Russia gets away with Ukraine, then the challenge Russia will send to the Western Europe is not going to be about the partners anymore. It's not going to be about Georgia again or about Moldova for that matter. But they will try something harder, something stronger, something more painful for those who were not able to respond properly to either Georgia or Ukraine. And being in Baltic states for this last week, I've visited Latvia, Estonia, and now I'm in Lithuania. I have a feeling that it's not just us Georgians who have this fear, but you can feel it here as well. You can feel people talking about it constantly in different forums, at different meetings, in different rooms. And it is logical, it is normal, it's obvious, it's practical, because we know Russia best. If there is anybody in this world who knows Russia, then that will be us Georgians, Baltics, Ukrainians, Moldovians, people who've experienced it so many times over and over again over the history. Actually, in Georgian case, it's been for 2 centuries, repeating itself, the story all the time repeating itself. What is it that we believe can be done in today's world in order to prevent the worst from happening? I always say that we Georgians are very simple people. We try to find simple answers to complicated questions, as complicated as difficult they are. And we say that if one day the full world says that there is a boundary to freedom, and this boundary is named Article 5 or whatever name we can think about it, then everything else will be occupied by the aggression and totalitarianism and the kind of regimes that unfortunately it's not only Russia are out there and dictating its rules. Once we put a and to the freedom, then everything else will be there, out there, for them to decide, for them to sort out, for them to take over. And I believe that there is no end to freedom. And if there are countries and states out there who say that we want to belong to the free world, but at the same time, not only saying it, but proving it every day. If there are people who are dying with the European Union and NATO flags in their hands, and this is what is happening in Ukraine today, this is what was happening in Georgia for the last 20 years almost every day, then the doors of the free world should be open for those countries. We cannot prevent states from wanting to be free. We cannot put an end to that desire and to that freedom. There is no country in the world who can tell to Georgians, oh, okay, but well, not this time. Wait for another couple of years or 5 years or 10 years for that matter. And then we might think whether you will really be part of the free world or not. Because every time we are given a timeline and we are told that please wait for another year or two, then it is understood as an open invitation by Russia for aggression. And this is what happened in 2008 after Bucharest. Russians have understood that time given to them as an invitation, open invitation for their actions and for sorting out things in Georgia. And they've tried to sort out things in Georgia, and they've stopped Georgia for 7 years, at least at this moment, if you look back from now. We believe that the only answer that NATO can give today to Russia, to Russia's aggressive politics, will be enlargement. NATO should be as bold as Russia is, as clear as Russia is. NATO should be as straightforward as Russia is. And that's the only answer to the problems both in Georgia and Ukraine. And that's the answer to all the troubles or all the worries that Eastern partners of Russia, of NATO, have today. Otherwise, if Warsaw Summit proves to be non-deliverable summit, I'm absolutely sure that it will be understood as another invitation by Russia for another aggression. And if you look at Georgia today, what is it that Russia might want in Georgia? It's a very clear picture. You just need to look at the map and everything is there. There is Georgia, who has two of its territories already under occupation. Russia, who has recognized them as independent states, having embassies there, having all kinds of agreements amongst each other, playing this game of statehood with those territories. And then you have rest of Georgia with this 200 kilometers of corridor of freedom, as we call it, where all the pipelines flow, where all the China-Europe relations, economic trade relations will flow, where if Iran deal goes through, hopefully, the gas and natural other natural resources corridor will be also. From South Ossetian border up to the Arctic, Russia controls everything. And from Georgia's border with Armenia, where the Russia's Gyumri base is based, down there, it's either Russia or other forces nicer than Russia operating. And there is just this 200 kilometers which is connecting the whole Caspian resources to Europe, which is connecting China to Europe, which is free from influence from any force of evil, from any forces of evil. This is the democracy, this is the freedom corridor. This is exactly what Russia wants to close. This is exactly where Russia wants to have a domination and where Russia wants to take over. That's it. They don't care about the rest of Georgia. They don't want Tbilisi or Batumi, for that matter. That corridor isn't good enough for them in order to control the whole segment of any energy security for Europe. Well, that's still not the only reason why Georgia matters. For practical terms, for many, maybe that is seen as the only reason why Georgia matters. We say Georgia matters because of the people who were ready to fight for 25 years, to die for 25 years for the cause of freedom and democracy. But if those things on which the modern Europe was built on are not important anymore and are not on market for sale anymore, then we say we need at least to secure that corridor. in order to keep Europe free from all kinds of influences from Russia and to keep at least one stream of freedom for energy security for the rest of the civilized world. And of course, Russia knows it the best. So if there is another new aggression in Georgia, then that's it. There is no big game. It's only half kilometer away from the main pipeline. They are already standing half kilometer away from the main pipeline. They are 20 minutes drive away from the capital city, Tbilisi. They don't need to put lots of effort. It's an overnight deal for them. What we are saying is that we need to deter them. If there is a war, the result is obvious. But that's exactly the Georgia's position. Current government tries its best to avoid the war in a country. Current government tries its best to be patient as much as it is possible. We are facing daily aggression from Russia, daily kidnapping of people on the Georgian territory, daily occupation of more and more land from Georgia, daily intervention of our airspace by the Russian military helicopters. But we say we keep strategic patience because we know what's behind it. They want us to get involved in a war and by that to close the history of independent Georgia once again at this moment of time. And we cannot allow for that. But at the same time, our voters obviously are asking a very obvious question. What is the red line? What is the end to it? When is the moment when you as a Minister of Defense are going to act? And that's kind of a question I'm asking to all our partners, and I will finish it there. What is it that you would suggest to Georgia to do under the very extremely deteriorating realities on the ground? When Russia's aggression is becoming more and more active, when their actions are becoming more and more desperate, when it is absolutely obvious that they are trying their best to prevent our integration to European Union or NATO for that matter, and when Mr. Lavrov says that he will not allow for NATO expansion on Georgia, he actually means it. Their militaries are trying their best on a daily basis to make it reality. What is it that we should be doing? How we should be acting? How Georgia should be behaving to be a loyal partner to the West, who obviously does not need another war in Europe? And we don't need the war in Europe, obviously, even more than anybody else. We have all those questions open-ended there. As I've told you, we found only one answer to those questions, and that is NATO enlargement. NATO brought peace everywhere it went to. We believe that the only reason why Estonia and Latvia, for example, are secure today and there is no conflict in Narva is because Estonia is part of NATO and European Union, because there is deterrence power of Article 5, because there is strength of NATO that is still working. That's the only side we know. Maybe there are others, and we will be absolutely happy to know those, and we would go for those. But unfortunately, so far, we have not got any answers other than that. So these are the thoughts from Tbilisi. These are the worries from Tbilisi. These are the options that are laid out in front of us. Either Warsaw will deliver on something that Europe was built on, whole united European peace, or there will be another very short, probably even shorter than in 2008, war in Georgia, by which there is a big potential for closing that little corridor of freedom that is flowing in this continent, connecting East and West between each other. Thank you very much, and looking forward for a very interesting conference.
Thank you, Madam Minister, for your speech. Thank you for joining us today. And now I would like to invite Charles Davidson, Executive Director of Kleptocracy Initiative, Hudson Institute, to take a moderator role, and all our participants of the first panel to take their seats.
Is this on? Well, the mic is on? Yes, it sounds like it. Well, first of all, I'd like to say that I'm very comfortable sitting here surrounded with so many courageous Lithuanians. It's absolutely wonderful. I've met some of you in Washington, and we've met many people putting this event together, and it's just been a wonderful experience. Hudson Institute, and I'll just say a very brief word about that. We're a public policy research organization, which of course in the vernacular means we're a think tank. And we are certainly well known for our being in favor of strong and engaged U.S. international leadership in partnership with our allies. We used to have some offices in Europe, actually, at one point. And today, we certainly recognize the importance of strengthening transatlantic alliances at a time when we face critical challenges to global democracy. I'd like to thank our co-sponsors in this event, the Eastern Europe Studies Center and Lorinas Kaksiunas, the Institute of International Relations and Political Science at Vilnius University, Ramunas Viliposokas, and I apologize for my pronunciation, the Konrad Adenauer Stiftung, Elisabeth Bauer, and then also Freedom House, which is represented here by Vytis Jurkonis. We have an office here. I'm also on the board of Freedom House, just in terms of full disclosure. And then the National Endowment for Democracy is represented here by Chris Walker. The start of this whole thing took place in your embassy in D.C., working with Zygmantas Pavilionis and Mindaugas Zikus. And this has just been a wonderful thing from start to finish. They've really pulled this thing along and done an incredible job. And we're extremely grateful to them. And of course, we thank President Grybauskaitė and the Republic of Lithuania for this marvelous reception, and we're really thrilled to be here. Now, getting to the topic of this first panel, as the founder of the Kleptocracy Initiative at the Hudson Institute, I have to refrain from saying anything since I'm the moderator. Though I may sneak in a comment towards the end. At the Hudson Institute, I'll just say one thing, which is that we've approached this issue as being very much an issue of national security, and by that I mean national security for the U.S. and its allies. And I think that's all I'll say at this point. We'll now go into the panel. And I hope we'll have about, if we stick to the schedule, we should have about 40 minutes for questions at the end. So each speaker will speak about 7 or 8 minutes. One can, in fact, say a great deal in 7 or 8 minutes. And so I'll be a little bit draconian in cutting people off if necessary, because with an audience like this is not the usual Q&A. It should be very interesting indeed. So we're going to start. It's the order will be as we see it on the program, except that Mrs. Deweisha will go last.
This is on. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, the distinction between democracy and non-democratic regime seems very clear, especially here in Lithuania. Hardly many people in Baltics trusted Russia since we gained independence. We knew rather well what the regime is capable of. Trade wars were constant. Maybe not so publicized in the West. Energy monopolies used for political influence were known and taken as a fact. Only recently things started to change. Now this conference very well shows that the problem of non-democratic, kleptocratic regimes is a thing of common political discourse in the West. Less than 3 months ago in Strasbourg, European Parliament adopted a resolution on EU-Russia relations. And it marked a passing of an era that was marked by reapproachment through engagement with Russia. Many tries and fails were registered throughout the years as politicians from Brussels or EU capitals tried to outrun each other by suggesting that a new initiative or program could help Russia come closer to democratic values of the West.
The document was approved by the European Parliament with an overwhelming majority, stated that the strategy of the past years was not a success and we need to find other ways of engagement with the Russian people and their regime. It had to look surprised when we very well know where the regime of Kremlin got its roots. It all started in the back alleys of St. Petersburg, or Leningrad, what it was known back then, where young boys would bully out coins, candies, or even bicycles from other kids in the street. Later on, when the boys grew up with some KGB training, they took over first the municipality of St. Petersburg and then the country. But the same principles of backyard bullies were kept throughout the history of independent Russia. And then there were believers. People naive enough to trust that Russia is changing to some sort of democracy. Probably the best example is Mr. Browder. He tried the flag. He carried the flag of changing corporate Russia. And bang, did he hit the wall. It would just be a hard lesson of trading in difficult market in emerging economies, if not for Mr. Browder's young lawyer, Mr. Magnitsky, who had to die for us to know the truth, being beaten, tortured, held in most cruel conditions, and then rejected care and left to die. Mr. Magnitsky documented how backyard bullies in state institutions operate. Russia acts as if it was above the international legal system. It finds fallacies within our society and easily points its finger saying, look, you're the same. We're just adding the Russian flavor to it. And yes, we have our worries. But the biggest issue with Western society is that we clench our fist and bang our chest saying, mea culpa. It is our democratic system that is challenging us to find wrongs within our society. But we have to be mindful about the cultural, political, and legal basement that our Western society is built on. For hundreds of years, our countries have been run by rule of law. By the way, Lithuanian and Polish constitution, written in 1791, was one of the first of its kind in the world, where working democracies and market economies that respect the private property. Western world has experienced the end of history when the Berlin Wall fell in 1989. The problem is that in the east of Ukraine, a new wall is being built, the same wall about which Samuel Huntington was talking. The other side of the cultural wall is not run by rule of law. It's run by law, meaning that if you need a law to justify government's action, you just create one. If it doesn't respect private property, therefore it acknowledges that theft from its people is justifiable. But West is awakening. Legal cases against Gazprom, Yugoslav stakeholders' successful case against Russian state, even MH17 investigation in Netherlands are right steps in the right direction. Answer to tyranny and kleptocracy is application of military-grade rule of law. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Landsbergis. Mr. Ponyanovsky?
Thank you very much from Georgia for helping. Thank you once again. I just wanted to say that I'm extremely grateful to be here. And the European Endowment for Democracy is a new organization based in Brussels. And we are not a think tank. So basically, we support people and we help solve some problems in the region. But being not a think tank and being among top intellectuals here is quite a challenge for me personally and for my organization. But let me say that what we've been doing last 2 years was actually trying to deal with the reality on the ground in different countries, especially in the both European neighborhoods, in the south and in the east. And by supporting people who are dealing and struggling on every day for democracy, for a better life of their nations, their people, by listening to their stories, we can understand a lot, especially we can understand a lot if we continue looking into this reality from Brussels, from Berlin, from Washington, from London, or even from Warsaw or Vilnius. So we have to be aware that although we make our efforts to understand what's going on, I think we should do more, because the reality on the ground often surpasses our ability to comprehend. It was here already several times mentioned in the initial speeches, in the keynote speeches, that we are in the West not able to read speeches of Mr. Putin, speeches of some other leaders, or even understanding what is going on. And this is a very painful experience over years. And not so long ago, endowment has participated in a big endeavor building a feasibility study on Russian language media freedom, on analyzing how this media space happened to be so dominated by only five main channels that are controlled by Kremlin. How it happened that the international community has allowed this to happen. And as a reaction of several partners in this discussion, one representative of the West's biggest military alliance said, well, when now the things went so far and this Russian propaganda is so effective, basically we can do nothing. Well, that's a very interesting conclusion for a long discussion what can be done. So in a sense, we have to think and revise our own methodologies, how we deal with our political analysis, why so often we are surprised by the turn of the events. And that is something where I would like to not answer, but to ask questions. What can we do better in order to avoid such a situation? For example, the subject of domination of Russian Kremlin-led propaganda in Russian language media space. This process took Putin, to eliminate a plurality, to eliminate independent media strong voice, took almost 12 years. So this was a long process. If we read Maria Lippmann's first comments on this from 2008, 2010, everything was already clear and well analyzed. But we couldn't even think how to react, and still we cannot, although we are already talking much more about this, because InfoWar, as a part of hybrid war in Ukraine, has demonstrated how important and how dramatic the influence is. And today, when endowment is trying to pursue this subject with different partners and donors, when we are trying to mobilize resources, still, we are talking of few millions euro, ready to invest in bringing back plurality and balance to this media space. Is it the right answer? It's not. So I think we are saying that we have learned lesson, but we haven't learned anything. And that is something very pessimistic that I want to convey today to this meeting. But at the same time, there is something positive, or maybe provocatively positive. If Putin needs to win hearts and minds of his people with this very false and artificial propaganda, that says something, that in the 21st century, a dictator cannot run the country without support from people, at least support that is artificially generated. And this is a positive thing, because that means we have ways to reach those people, and we have to make an effort to reach to them. So if we're talking about strategy engaging with Russia, we have to make more people-to-people contact. We have to invest more in free media and civil society in the whole region and in Russia itself. We have to build on our strength, and our strength is plurality. Our strength is access to people's minds and hearts, and never give up on this, and invest a lot of resources and efforts. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, Mr. Skatkowski, we can use the other mic, I think. And I would say this is a very positive message, in fact. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I'm very proud to be here. Thank you for the invitation to speak. So I will be speaking a little bit about the effectiveness of non-democratic regimes in security and defense dimension in a slightly technocratic way, but I think it also deserves an attention. So when we think of the effectiveness of security and defense policy, first dimension that comes to mind that is very important is the political-military interface. So this is the ability of the political class to impose a direction upon the military. There is a certain popular view that military issues or defense issues should be left to military people, but it's basically wrong, not only because of the threat of an abuse of military power, but it's also it's wrong. I mean, the research shows that when militaries are left on their own, they tend to degrade. And when we look at non-democratic regimes, the their experience, I mean, their account on in this issue is mixed. I would say that we have certain regimes that, at the beginning, tend to be quite effective in imposing the political military direction and in rendering the military effective to their will. For instance, Third Reich is one of those cases. One could also argue that at a certain point Vladimir Putin has also been quite effective in bringing back the quality and effectiveness of Russian troops. But as we look at those regimes as time passes by, we can also see that especially when successors take over, they are not able to exert such an effective control over their militaries. Another issue is an ability to coordinate different security and military instruments. This is especially important nowadays, as we face conflict situations that are in a gray zone between peace and war. Democracies basically recognize this division because democratic and civil rights have to be somehow limited in a time of war, so that we have to clearly delineate this issue. On the other hand, however, non-democratic regimes are thus able to be more effective in this gray zone. Hence, the hybrid warfare and its effect in Ukraine. I would also like to mention that in Central Eastern Europe, we have a certain problem with both issues. I mean, our military culture is to a great degree we've inherited the culture from Warsaw Pact times with a degree of its repetitiveness and shallowness. And there is a need to improve that dimension. And third thing is the quality of personnel. When we think of the effectiveness of military force, we usually tend to concentrate on the equipment. So we usually think that the army that possesses more gear is more effective than another army. The research shows actually that what is as technology advances, what is more critical, more and more critical, is actually the quality of your personnel. And that one is actually based on the quality of your human capital. So non-democratic regimes, in most cases, are not effective in this account, because that sort of a human capital is based on the quality of your human network, on the level your people trust each other and can cooperate one with another. And with one exception, this is again the Third Reich, which was actually very good in this dimension. Regimes tend to be poor and to impose military drill, which with new military revolutions is less and less effective in terms of waging war. So when I come to certain conclusions, I would like to say that in Central Eastern Europe we should be serious about our defense and security policy. And as we see across the region, as we see growing defense budget, we should also be thinking on how to increase the level how to increase the quality of our political control over the militaries. So I think that we should invest in faculties of strategy. We should also invest in political control over the military, also in the parliament. In most cases of Central Eastern European countries, I know that parliamentary control over the military is usually very formal and very superficial. As I was trying to indicate, the defense policy usually benefits from an exchange of thought and from a strong political direction. And here I will just make it. Thank you.
I'm really pleased and honored to be here and to speak for such a distinguished audience. And I would like to you to pay some attention to the screen because we have some presentation for you. Today's topic is how non-democratic regimes kleptocracies work. So I will try to speak, but I will try to speak about a war Russia or Putin's regime wages against the Western world. I would like to start from a quite well-known quotation of Leon Trotsky, because last week I spoke at the conference in Krynica, Krynica Economic Forum, and I was called warmonger the thing is that really it could be the only true thing Leon Trotsky told ever in his life, but we should pay attention to these things, and it's especially true when it comes to Russia and to Putin's regime. We may not be interested in war with Putin's regime, but Putin's regime is interested in war with Western world. But I will speak not about the war in this normal terms, not about this conventional war, not about hybrid war or new generation of war, how they put it themselves, Putin's regime. I will speak about some secret world they wage against us, against Western world, just constantly. So I will start from the quotation of Spanish prosecutor. I will not read these quotations, but I would like to you to pay attention to them. If not an analyst, not a journalist, and not some other pundit in the West speaks about the direct relations between criminal world with Kremlin and its prosecutor who investigates these relations for decades, we really should pay attention to that. And this quotation, it might be, you might be, have got this quotation, at least some of you, but the next quotation from the same prosecutor is even more important, and I would like to read this, not the old quotation, but the second part, which is in red. Russian security services control criminal groups and use them to do things the government cannot acceptably do. This is the main thing how kleptocracies work. And it, we should not be naive. If they do such things in Turkey, just to destabilize the country, just supplying weapons to the Kurds, they do the same things in Europe, in United States, and all over the world. The second element of how these kleptocracies work is terrorism. Drug trafficking. So it was the year of 1963 when Nikita Khrushchev, at that time leader of Soviet Union, said that deception and drugs are our first two strategic echelons in the war with capitalism. The same is now. They are employing drug trafficking just to achieve the goals they want to achieve. And I want you to remind the recent quotation by Yuri Shvets on the hearings on Litvinenko's case, when he directly said that Putin and his closest ally Viktor Ivanov, who is currently held by some coincidence of Russian narcotics agency, have been implicated in helping run a drug smuggling and money laundering ring in St. Petersburg. But the thing is that it's not about these allegations. The thing is that, as you said, Karen, that most Western intelligence agencies know everything about this regime. And the third quotation is about the thing that US intelligence agencies had detected a partnership between Arellano Felix organization and Russian mafia groups. And one of these mafia groups is former KGB affiliated group. So this is a long-term strategy of KGB to wage a war against the West, employing these drug trafficking organizations and all the rings of drug trafficking. But we should go to the next element, and we should go to the back to the very beginning, how this criminal regime started, and what was this very beginning. So this is the famous quotation of US Senator and then President candidate John McCain. And you can read Litvinenko's book. You can read the other book, which is written by David Sutter. So it doesn't matter if it Russian approach or KGB approach of former KGB agent or a scholar in the West. If you read these things, you can you go to this same conclusion. This regime started from the origin of this regime is terror acts in Moscow in 1999. But let's go just further into the history. And this is quotation of the highest ranking Soviet bloc intelligence officer to ever detect. Mr. Yon Pachepa was the head of Romanian foreign intelligence. And he definitely knows what he's talking about. So, his quotation is the threat of international terrorism was born at the Lubyan. And now let's go to some other quotations of Alexander Litvinenko and the recent one of Michael Weiss, who wrote a really good and eye-opener at the Daily Beast just 2 weeks ago. So the center of global terrorism is not Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan, or the Chechnya. Terrorism infection creeps any worldwide from the cabinets of Lubyanka Square. And now, even as Washington touts its counter-terrorist partnership with Moscow, evidence points to Putin's intelligence service practically helping the Islamic State. So it's again about the current day situation. It's not about the history. And the last but not least is about business just business. It's not business as usual, like we call, sometimes we call politics, but just business in Russia. So it's unfortunately, I didn't find who is the author of this, again, quite famous quotation, but this quotation describes Putin's regime very well. The biggest export of Russia is not oil or gas, it's corruption. So when Russia is exporting corruption, it's not just by coincidence. It's not just because they are trying to do it for their business purposes. It's because the corruption is foundation of Putin's regime. And they are trying to make the same system in the West. It's their ultimate goal. That's how Putin's regime works. So if it looks like a criminal, if it acts as like a criminal, and if it employs criminals to achieve their goal, it's a criminal regime. That's my final conclusion.
Thank you very much, and I have to apologize for my voice. I'm still recovering from a cold, which is why you really should not touch that glass. I wanted to pick up on some of the themes of the previous speakers, and but also primarily focus on what do kleptocracies actually do to survive. On the one hand, they have to convince people at home that they are better off with this kleptocratic regime than having another type of system. And on the other hand, they have to make sure that their own people get an understanding of the other countries, that they are not a better alternative. So how do they do that? And I want to focus on a couple of issues that have to do with the crossing of red lines by the current Russian regime, the signs of desperation of the current Russian regime, and the approach to a country that is an alternative to Russia in the political system, and also the fact that what Marius just mentioned, that you can't really get away from the Russian aggression, whether it's verbally or physically or in cyberspace, even if you try your utmost. And I want to focus on the case of Sweden as a very illustrative example, because Sweden does have that international image of standing up for democracy, human rights, the fundamental values, the rule of law, for being a prosperous country, and for actually also trying to promote all of these values abroad. So what does the current Russian government do? It has to discredit Sweden and the Swedish government, and it has done so systematically over the course of the last couple of months in particular. But of course, that started much earlier. That started years ago. So what we have seen recently is that when, for example, if we go back to the time before Russia annexed Crimea and started to attack eastern Ukraine, in 2013, when a Swedish athlete tried to stand up for the rights of homosexuals and painted her nails in rainbow colors, she was reprimanded by a Russian athlete who declared that this was outrageous and provocative, and also declared that in Russia men live with women and girls have relationship with boys. that what happens in Sweden is depraved and all wrong. This goes, of course, totally against the understanding of fundamental values that we have in the free, democratic world. But it plays, of course, into the hands of the current kleptocratic and rather autocratic regime in Russia that has to make its people feel that what is happening in Russia is good and better than abroad. So a country like Sweden has to be portrayed as a depraved country that is not living up to its ideals. And when the Swedish Foreign Minister Carl Bildt, going back all the way to 2008, defended Georgia and also Moldova and Ukraine, and started with his Polish colleague the Eastern Partnership Initiative. When he did that, what happened as a response from Moscow? The Swedish Foreign Minister had to be discredited. He was ridiculed on Russian national television. And not only him, also the Supreme Commander of the Swedish Armed Forces was ridiculed. The Swedish Army was ridiculed. The country as such was ridiculed on public national television. That is part of how a kleptocracy survives, to portray the alternatives as bad, as ridiculous, as nothing like the strong and decent country that is led by Vladimir Putin. What have we seen even more recently? Sweden, as a formerly non-aligned country in military terms, although not a neutral country, it has to be said, as a member of the European Union. Sweden has been threatened openly by the Russian Foreign Ministry through its official channels in a public press conference that should it dare to join NATO, then Russia would, and verbatim, would retaliate. There would be military consequences. Retaliation. Why? How can it be interpreted as an attack on Russia when Sweden possibly makes a choice in the distant future to join a defensive alliance for its own security? But that is again part of what the kleptocracy and the autocratic regime that we currently see in Moscow has to do to survive. But it takes rather desperate dimensions when that follows a long series of abusive attacks on representatives of the Swedish government, of the Swedish armed forces. The Swedish Foreign Minister and the Supreme Commander of the Swedish Armed Forces has, in the last couple of months, been abused with. They have amnesia. The submarines that they pretend they have found don't exist. They are just rubber boats or fishing boats, they will see. Until they actually did find a Russian submarine that sank in 1919. So quite a long time ago. But that doesn't mean that there isn't actually now also a presence of Russian submarines in Swedish waters or near Swedish waters. But all of this seems quite desperate. Why would the Russian embassy in Stockholm, through its Twitter and Facebook account, throw constantly abuse at the host country, which breaks with any of the standard diplomatic protocols? Just imagine any other civilized European country doing that to another civilized European country, abusing them openly through the formal channels and ridiculing countries on national television at home, constantly and systematically. That seems rather crazy. one could say, or desperate. And it is those red lines that are constantly being pushed, and it's that desperation and the damage that is actually being done, both to interstate relations, because Sweden has been a country, especially under the current government, that has done its utmost to be nice and friendly and non-provocative, to endure all of the abuse it has been getting through the formal channels from Russia. But that hasn't stopped the regime in Moscow from continuing. So what I am very concerned about is what this behavior does to intergovernmental relations, to relations with Russia at the highest political level, but also to what it does to the perception of individual Russians, of the countries in the West, of having this constant abuse and mockery, the ridiculing of the free world out there, how that makes them more aggressive, creates an image of the big, bad, evil world, when all what they are doing is actually standing up for the rule of law, securing the good, safe, and prosperous living of their citizens, or at least trying to do their best to do so with all the flaws of the modern democracies. So one of the things that, and there I want to also echo what you said, so one of the things that I find most striking is that a Russian friend of mine and a colleague who is living in a European Union member state said recently to me, well, you know, with all of this polarization and that provocation of sentiments against Western countries, against the European Union, against NATO, what is there that we can do? Her solution is, I am going to invite as many friends and relatives as I can to my new host country, so that they can see with their own eyes that that picture that is being painted on Russian television and through the Russian so-called news, that that is flawed, that the people are not bad people in the West, that we are all normal human beings. And with that, I just want to end. Thank you.
Thanks. So I'll just add a few comments that try to pull things together. It seems to me one of the most interesting challenges that we have, that we are beginning to overcome, is that we actually agree that there is such a thing as a kleptocracy in Russia, and that it has certain features, and that it operates internationally, and that we, as sovereign states, do not benefit from it. So we have in Russia a leadership that fundamentally is nationalizing the risk and privatizing the reward of its own economic development. The people around Putin are not going to lose as a result of our sanctions. He has made this clear. The Russian people will lose, and he doesn't care. When some of the sanctioned individuals came home in the last year after Crimea was illegally annexed, he asked them to de-offshoreize their assets. Some of them did, or they said that they were. Clearly, none of them did entirely. And as often happens in this strange political system where in Stalin's time a political leader could give a speech that actually was called Dizzy from Success about the Ukrainian famine. You had Putin allegedly at the New Year's party for his people, telling them a story, which went like this. It's about weak property rights in Russia and the power of the state and of his own power. He said, look, we all know chickens can exercise ownership of eggs and they can get fed while they're sitting on the eggs. But we all know that at the end of the day, they don't own the eggs. He said this to his own people. So this was followed by certain people like Deripaska and others, the names familiar to many of you, giving a public statement that he's made a lot of money, but everything he owns belongs to the state. This is, at the core, what a kleptocracy is about. But you can't go to the Russian people and expect to win an election on the basis of this. So they had to do something about it. And they had to create what in cultural theory is called a simulacrum. They had to create a virtual world occupied by, built by people like Surkov, and occupied by fairy democracies, fairy democrats, you know, dancing on top of Christmas cakes or something like this, in which everyone was happy. They were marching alongside other democrats in the West, in the war against terror, and so forth, while they were doing what they were doing. And democracies are based on elections, so one after the other was built and stolen. Even today, in Kostroma, the one single local election that included a member of the opposition, Open Russia's office was raided by the police, where they said a murder had taken place on the day of the local election, in the one single place in all of Russia where there was a single opposition candidate. So clearly they know what reality is because they act against it. They know what it is. They act against it. And they're assuming, and let's face it, perhaps they're not wrong entirely, that we are stupid and that we do actually want to sit down with him and do a deal at the end of the day. Over Syria, or over Crimea, Berlusconi can come and go, and behind Berlusconi there are presumably legions of other people who would be willing to cut a deal. And so I think when we talk about kleptocracies and what we can do, the information war is extremely important, because we need to challenge this simulacrum. We need to say that what you're saying is lies. I have to say, you know, I feel as an American slightly embarrassed. You know, academics are not supposed to praise the State Department. It's just not done. So I apologize, you know. But I have to say, I was really very pleasantly surprised when the Secretary of State lent his support for putting on the website a series of lies from the Russians about the downing of the plane over Ukraine. And then this has continued. We have to be blunt and clear. We have to be united on information. But then we also have to identify enablers in our own systems. We have to do something about offshore banking. We have to do something about anonymous accounts that are buying up Mayfair, Monaco, Miami, and unfortunately, they're not buying up all of the Trump Tower, but they're close. I think they like it. And it's a real threat. So this is something that we can do. We need to call it like it is, an information, and we need to realize that our own elites, our own financial centers, are not perfect, and it has allowed these systems to emerge.
Marvelous. Well, I'd certainly like to echo the last two or three sentences that Karen has pronounced, and it's a major focus of the program that I run at Hudson, which she just described. So now, for the rest of the hour, we have about 45 minutes, we're going to do something a little different. because we don't have an audience of students or of people that we're concerned that there will be 10-minute speeches instead of questions. So what I invite you to do is to, by all means, ask questions, and those are welcome, but short comments are also much appreciated. I think that's very appropriate in this context. So do we have a microphone circulating? Okay, terrific. So this young man over there. Any questions or comments to kick this off?
I'm Audronis, a Socialist member of parliament. A few things. Unfortunately, I couldn't see here a Georgian minister of defense. But I hope that some Georgians are here from her delegation. Okay, no Georgians. It means no advice, because she asked for advice how Georgia should behave in this quite a difficult circumstances. Anyway, a few thoughts about the kleptocracy and about the secret accounts and about all this stolen property which is very securely and securely placed in our countries. This is I'm just saying nothing new, I'm just repeating what Khodorkovsky told, if I'm not mistaken, half a year ago here in Vilnius. He said, you are talking about the human rights violation, about democracy, but you are doing nothing. First of all, you should make your homework. It means our legal system, European legal system, as well as the American legal system, should be, if I may say so, infected by a very strong political will, by our legislation bodies, which would pass the laws, which would help, simply saying, to confiscate the stolen property. But for that you need very simple thing, political will, and strong leadership. During my 25 years of political career, what I see in Europe especially, less and less political leadership. It looks like Europe is taken by mid-sized rank bureaucrats, but not by strong leaders. This is just, I would say, comment. Thank you.
My name is Marius Velichko, I'm the Vice Minister of Defense, and I would like to place my question to Mr. Pomenovsky and others. Actually, what you were saying right now is that Russia is doing this and Russia is doing that. It abused and ridiculed the Swedish government. We should do something. Actually, I didn't hear any of the examples what we should do. Well, I'm the state representative, so it's very hard for me maybe to see what we can do, what you are those people who are inside who can give us an advice. So, for example, as you mentioned, we should do something with Russian propaganda in Russia. How can we do that? How can we achieve that? There is not a single source of Western TV broadcasting. Recently, the CNN got the broadcasting license in this year, March. 85% of Russian-speaking people living in Russia get the information from the Russian TV, which is 95% owned by Russian and Kremlin people. So actually, I would like more pragmatic examples. What should be the steps, from your point of view? What should be the states doing in that? Because all these theoretical things that we should do, and we should do this, and we should do that, we all know that we should do.
Thank you. Of course, I had only 7 minutes here, and the report that the European Endowment for Democracy has published and delivered to the government has 200 pages on this. And they are very concrete steps with the budgets already estimated. Just to give you a hint which direction we go. The first is that in our report, talking to very, very elite group of experts, we actually decline the possibility of establishing a Western-based channel that will possibly address information to the Russian people. This will not work today. And this is not the way to deal with the problem. We have to use our strength. Our strength is plurality and the fact that independent media exists in the Russian language media space. And this media space, it's not only Russia, because Ukraine also, Belarus, Moldova, and many other locations where we have a lot of Russian talents, Russian language talents, who can deliver messages and who can multiply those messages. So what we are talking here, we are trying to mobilize funds to support all existing media outlets, even those in Russia, like Novaya Gazeta, like Echo Moskvy, like TV Dosh, but many also smaller outlets, or newly established Medusa, successors of the Lenta.ru in Riga. So there are ways, but we have to be coordinated, and we have to do this in a different way than before, and we have to mobilize big funds. Second is the content. This is not about a news or about just providing truth. The issue is that those who are watching and already captured by state channels are, in a sense, very difficult to win back. So we have to find a way to build trust. One of the weaknesses we have analyzed and diagnosed of the state Russian channels, they talk a very little about people's real life stories, about local news, about what's happening specifically in their city, in their village. So if we can focus independent media to talk more about this and to help them financially to focus on those real life stories, it will bring truth of the life to the attention of the people who are interested in it. And winning trust can lead to more participation in those independent media. So it's a complex agenda, but we already know what to do. What I was complaining about was that the governments to whom we deliver this report still are not mobilized enough to respond to it. That includes European governments and US. So there is still a lot of work to be done to mobilize new resources to address those issues. Because now everybody is saying that since last 20 years, we've been spending a lot of money to support independent media in the region. If everything was done so well, why the situation is so bad?
You wanted to add?
Yeah, I wanted to just add from the foreign policy perspective also, I think it is very important, as you said as well, that every single government invests their resources in communicating what they do and how they do it and in speaking to their own people and to the Russian people. Because what is happening right now, what I see in Twitter, Facebook, in the different channels, the Russian regime has spread out and created lots of new accounts, official channels of spreading the myths and disinformation and ridiculing of the various different actors that are standing up for civil rights and the rule of law, and that are critical of Russian aggression against Ukraine and other countries. And the problem we have is that not all governments are enough aware of this issue or ready to invest their resources on it. And I think one of the very good examples is the country here. Lithuania is doing a great job in the information arena, where your foreign minister is one of the actors that actually does dispel myths immediately and comments on current affairs, on critical issues. And that is needed, and that needs to come not just from one or two very active actors in cyberspace, but actually unite as a united front from all different countries. Because when I see that, for example, the German government or the French government make no comment on the imprisonment of kidnapped officers and individuals, and certain countries do and other countries don't, that is a big problem. Although, of course, you can always argue that the deep concern that is being expressed in official messages is not enough and will not change anything. But, of course, it is part of the diplomatic game. And if more and more countries express their deep concern and their criticism and are vocal about it, that message is heard in Moscow and Putin will be reacting to it.
Yeah, very quick comment. I think there are many things to do, but we should start, we should start from explaining the things we're talking today about to our own audiences, not to some others, not to Russian audience, but to our own audiences. How many people in the West, including Lithuania, think in these terms? How many people in Germany? Let's come to the thing I started. I was called a warmonger, just not far from here in Poland, in the country which was, which still is on the front line on this war against Putin. So the first thing is to explain to our own audiences that, let's say, a war. When we speak about a war against terrorism, Russia is not an ally, and it can't be an ally on the war on terrorism, because terrorism was created, well, at least part of it was created in Russia, and they are employing terrorists to achieve their goals.
Thank you, Maris. We're going to go to a question right in the center, and I'm just going to add one sentence to this answer, which is the question of the gentleman, which is we're not going to be able to get around the question of resources. Our enemy is spending incredible amounts of resources on this, and we're gonna. I mean, they're using bazookas, and we're using water pistols. It doesn't matter how smart we are; we're not going to win.
Thank you, Mr.
Chairman. It's okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You are the executive director of the Kleptocracy Initiative. I don't know how many people in the hall knows how it works. If not, maybe we could talk later on about it. I am a political analyst from Mykolas Riomeris University here in Lithuania, but also some civic activist who started activity in Sąjūdis, one of the founders of the Sąjūdis, 27 years ago, and I still keep relations with those Ukrainians, Russian Democrats, and so on. So one of the main questions, really, maybe it sounds a little bit naive, but what Ukrainians are putting and the Russian Democrats are putting up. The most serious weapon against Putin regime would not be so much sanctions as a very clear information about kleptocracy of Putin's regime. If such information exists, I know that political analysts like Professor Davisha does this excellent, brilliant book, but if such information exists, why it's not possible to put it in the open air for the public in Russia to get it and understand it? I know that in Russia now many people, even from intelligentsia who are not participating in the political life, artists, actors, scientists, very much now overwhelmed with this nationalist fever about Crimea. But still, when you're talking about to them about kleptocracy regime, or Mr. Peskov watches on his hand, and all these other things, they say, what? Where are the arguments? Where is the information about all this? Now, some of you could tell me, probably also you're telling to Russians, Ukrainians, Democrats, that, well, unfortunately, because of the legal system, we cannot disclose all this information. Then Ukrainians are coming and saying, look, why we could not get information about Mr. Yanukovych and all these oligarchs before the Maidan, and I was talking to those civic activists before the Maidan, and why it was possible for us to get some information about Mr. Firtash dealing after the Maidan. So the question is, and I think very serious, and maybe your initiative on kleptocracy could work on that, but if the team was collected of political analysts, prosecutors, lawyers, specialists in money laundering, who would look to this issue with the professional understanding, it would very much help both for the democracy in Russia and also, by the way, for the democracy in Ukraine, because everybody forgot that Regions Party which now became opposition bloc, or even a RPF party, are now coming stronger and stronger. And if they would get more and more support, and the political ratings of the parties who went down leadership by President Poroshenko and Prime Minister Yatsenyuk would come down, it's not exactly clear what could be the future foreign political orientation of Ukraine if the people in Ukraine would not get information about regions party, oligarchs, secret dealings against the people. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I imagine most people in this room agree with you. Yes, the gentleman here in the third row.
Well, my name is Andrius Kubilius. I'm from the Senate Parliament. And very brief two comments and general question. First of all, to our Swedish colleague, I would like to say welcome to the club. Because what you were talking, it sounded like you are talking about Lithuania for the last 25 years. What Russian embassy is doing, what Russian propaganda is doing. So welcome to the club. When you will decide to join NATO, we shall support. That's obvious way. Mr. Putin is doing a good job to convince you to join real club. To Professor Davis, really, thanks a lot for your book. It's really very powerful, very effective, I would say, textbook which should be translated into all Western community languages, just for everybody to understand what kleptocracy regime we have very close to our borders. But the problem is that we know what maybe, as Marius said, somebody still should learn more about kleptocracy regime in Western community countries and so on and so on. But more or less, we understand what we have, what a challenge we have. But bigger challenge is that, for example, I don't understand why still in the Western community leadership attitude towards this regime is, we know what we have. When we are talking about, let's say, that the Western community should support Ukraine because it's under aggression of this kleptocratic regime, or what Georgian friends were talking, what kind of answer we are getting? We don't want to provoke Russia. So when you have kleptocratic regime, or what McCain called, gangster regime, which is ruling petrol station, such an attitude, not to support, for example, Ukraine in a proper way, exactly what is provoking such a regime. So my question to Professor Davisha, will you write a book about analysis of Western community leadership situation? Why they are still so naive when they are looking to the behavior of such a kleptocratic regime? Because if we shall not understand what is happening really in Western community capitals, we can talk as many as we want about kleptocratic regime in Russia. But the problem is not only with kleptocratic regime in Moscow. The problem is with the democratic regimes in Western community.
Thank you for this question. I planted it with you obviously. Well, I live in a small town in Ohio. So for 8 years, I didn't have to go to think tank meetings in downtown DC or embassy diplomatic receptions where everybody's always looking over their shoulders and wondering whether Freedom House is doing as good a job as NED or, the kind of small politics that becomes very big and important, although both. Those think tanks are absolutely amongst the most important in terms of their global reach. But I would say, if I can just use the example of my book, what it illustrates, not what I say in it, but the limitations on its publication and circulation. Cambridge University Press would not publish it in the UK because of the inadequacy of British libel laws. My own publisher, fabulous publisher in the US, will not give foreign rights to any country whether it's Lithuania or Canada, and God knows, not the UK, because they are scared about the Russians and their infinitely deep pockets suing Simon & Schuster. And if Cambridge University Press, which last year had net profits of £400 million, is unwilling to defend free publishing, and if Simon & Schuster and my own editor, who personally was the editor for All the President's Men, will not sanction the selling or the giving of these rights to a foreign country, then, or to publishers in a foreign country, then we truly have an example of Russia's soft power. They are scared. They are scared. And so my view is that when, in answer to the question of what can be done, I have some specific ideas. I think that the archives of Novaya Gazeta and Dozhd and other serious journalists like Roman Shlainov and others should immediately be put on Western servers. Are we going to wait until the police arrive and announce that there was a murder in the offices that suspected, and their servers, their Russian servers, are arrested? Wake up. This is what will happen. We need to get their archives because they know the story. That's one. We need to publish in Russian, not only my book, but other accounts, and there are many, and circulate them. There used to be USIA offices in all American embassies abroad. Are we still giving out books or not? What the hell are we doing in USIA offices? Of course, USIA doesn't exist. That's the answer to that question. We need to change libel laws. I mean, there's so many brave people in the same as here. What would be so wrong with saying that protection of publication will be extended to Lithuania of anything that is published in the United States, period. And I think also to create a government-sponsored fund to indemnify those writers, journalists, and entrepreneurs who have had dealings, not pleasant dealings, with the Russians. Lots of Russian entrepreneurs are trying to sue Russia or Russian individuals in Western courts, whether in Stockholm, I think another reason why Sweden has a target on its back, whether in Stockholm, UK, or in the EU. But all of us who might be threatened with this are fighting as individuals against other individuals, but behind them stands the Russian state. And we need to create some kind of unified fund to indemnify. It should be more than Bill Browder, who can publish his books in 14 languages. There's a reason why these books aren't being published. So I think that there are very specific things that could be done.
It's a perfect goal for your organization.
Just a quick comment on why is it that not more Western leaders are speaking up and not more systematically? Well, I mean, if I'm following who says what when things happen in Russia, then there are clear patterns. From Paris and from Berlin, we're not hearing a lot of criticism because of the Minsk Agreement. Because there is, I think, some understanding that, or misperception perhaps, that if strong criticism comes from Berlin or from Paris, then that may jeopardize the very fragile situation in eastern Ukraine. It is, of course, questionable whether that is the right way to go. It wouldn't be my choice, but that's clearly a choice of the government. Sweden. Why has Sweden become very quiet? Does that have something to do with the Swedish foreign minister? No, because she has spoken up for human rights and democracy with regard to other countries. Why are there no very strong comments on a regular basis to do with Russia and Ukraine nowadays? Well, Sweden is currently campaigning for a non-permanent seat on the United Nations Security Council. It may or may not be an explanation. And there are more such explanations, of course, because why are we seeing the blindness in Western capitals? Well, it's not really a blindness. It is the wish that that thing goes away, because nuclear weapons are scary, and Russia has nuclear weapons. And the military doctrine of December 2014 does not exclude first use. That is one among many explanations for why there is that strong effort not to provoke.
So, Chris Walker at the National Endowment for Democracy. Just a quick observation on the gentleman's comment about getting information into the Russian information space about kleptocracy. I think it's worth noting that even now, under these terribly trying conditions, you have courageous Russians within Russia doing this, including Alexei Navalny, and you see what it's gotten him. But I think these people need to be supported as much as ever now. This discussion has been terrific. I think among many important points, it started to get out the connection in the censorship, propaganda, and kleptocracy relationship, because the censorship is necessary to suppress the understanding of domestic audiences. Propaganda flourishes with censorship. They're two sides of the same coin. But the censorship can't work as well outside of Russia's borders, so Russia's propaganda looks to cloud and kind of muddy the waters about what really is happening. So there are purposes on both sides. But my question is more direct on the resource question. Charles alluded to the fact that Russia, with Russia today, invests something on the order of $300 to $400 million a year, as they say. But the amount of money that goes into all of the instruments that are used to impact the information space at home and abroad from Russia is far larger. We don't really know what it is, because this comes from so many different sources. It's very similar in places like China, which is investing billions of dollars a year in its information efforts from a variety of different sources. So we know this at this point. We know that this challenge is there after Crimea, with the Russian propaganda onslaught coming into the public space and the Western media space. We know this at some level. But I detected a little bit of a contradiction during the discussion between what we need to do as a priority on responding to this. If I understood correctly, some were saying, well, we still need to explain to decision makers and policy makers so that they really get it, how important it is, on the one hand. On the other hand, we've had many studies and efforts, including the one done by the European Endowment for Democracy, which really engaged an enormous number of people thinking about this. And yet, Jerzy Pomianowski said that the response isn't forthcoming from the government. So if others would like to answer this, I'd welcome it. But I'd be very interested to hear from Jerzy. Is it that the governments don't understand the depth of the problem, that they're not providing the investment? Or is it that there's something else at work?
Well, when I was studying sociology, how to estimate the drinking habits about students was to count the bottles, empty bottles, every evening outside the doors of the hostel, student hostel. So what I can judge only is the government's reaction and how much money they allocate every program to address those issues. Why they are doing so little, whether they don't want to read reports, or they don't understand them, or they have no capacity to comprehend, is difficult to answer. But the reality is today that the resource mobilization, the mobilization of political will, is still very low.
My name is Evgenia Chirikova. I'm environmental and civil society activist of Russia. And I want to say for you, thank you very much for this discussion. It's very important for Russian civil society, really. And I have a big question. Where Mr. Putin take money for his regime? For war in Georgia, in Ukraine, for annexion in Crimea, for propaganda? I can explain where. Unfortunately, it's Western money, because Western countries pay to Mr. Putin for Russian gas, oil, and other fossil fuel. And I have very small and very short question. Say me, please, when Western country to stop buys Russian fossil fuel?
Thank you, Edward. I think we have a long gentleman over here who's had his hand up for a long time. If we can get the mic all the way over there.
Thank you. My name is John Moff, Chatham House. I have another question to Karen Dalashad, and this one is about the so-called oligarchs in reference to Deripaska. And I just wondered what your thoughts might be on Western sanctions policy towards Russia. Because so far, people think that the sanctions have drawn a very clear distinction between the sort of insider crony types around President Putin and the, let's say, senior business people, I don't like that term, oligarchs, it's never relevant really, outside. Although those people, as you intimated in the case of Deripaska, they are effectively in their assets, are at the service of the state when required. Do you think it's right to continue to sustain that distinction between the two of them in our sanctions policy?
Well, could I just acknowledge the comments by the environmental activist Chirkova, who I've known about but never met, had the pleasure of meeting before, and I'm a great fan of your work. And on what you said, I think that what you said is very important, and most important not just because our money going back to fund Kremlin projects, but when BP spills vast amounts in the Gulf of Mexico, and the cost to BP is astronomical, how can BP stay afloat for its shareholders except by going into Russia, where Greenpeace tells us 14 million barrels of oil are spilled because there are no environmental controls into Russia's rivers, so polluting them that ice flows have turned black every spring. This is something very dirty that we are allowing our own companies to do, because the Kremlin is getting money out of the ground without caring about their own populations. All the villages along those rivers are being deserted because people can't make a living. The villages and the rivers are dying. So we have a huge moral stain when we allow our companies to invest in Russia without any environmental controls. So I would wish you well in your activism. On the question of oligarchs, this group is really showing signs of fraying. I would never have predicted Yakunin leaving the Russian Railways position. I always thought that this businessman's group around Putin was pretty tight, but I think that declining budgets make the pressures on them to actually be efficient so great that people who were chosen not because of their business acumen but because of their closeness to the president can't do the job. So I think that there's the obviously the inner circle of the cronies, and we know that Yakunin was replaced by somebody close to Rottenberg. So that group is still holding, but there are more people, I think, who are showing evidence that they don't want to lose what they've made. But I do. I personally think that the sanctions were a huge step, particularly in the way that they were announced by the U.S. government, where, for example, they said that so-and-so is sanctioned because of his close business relationship to a senior Russian government official. You know, they know who is related to whom, and they clearly have a lot more information that they can roll out, and we should encourage it.
I think Tomas wanted to add something to this, and then
Marius. Just a couple of words on the supporting question on the import of gas and oil, I mean, which incidentally coincides with your comment on the environmental impact, because the increase in demand for Russian gas and oil in recent years from Western Europe had also to do with an environmental policy in Europe. So, I mean, we were going to substitute, for instance, coal with gas that is cleaner in terms of the CO2 emissions. So somebody was overlooking other aspects of the other environmental aspects of the of this issue. And unfortunately, I don't see other sources for hope in terms of the reduction of the demand other than global trends. Luckily, those trends are unfavorable for the Russian energy complex, and they will be soon facing a choice either to export under their level of of return, or they will have to cease to use energy as political weapon. Thank you.
Two short comments to Yevgeny. Until our governments in the West will understand that we are at war with Russia, the buying of Russian oil and gas will not stop. So that's about this understanding I'm talking about. On Putin and oligarchs in Russia, I'm afraid I would a bit disagree with Karin. To my mind, we overestimate the role of Putin and underestimate the role of system in Russia. It's a KGB-based system, and Putin is just one guy in the system. Yes, he's a godfather, yes, but he is not a tsar in Russia. And all the oligarchs, all the oligarchs are part of this system. So there is no hope that of some coup in Russia against Putin or something like that.
We have a question.
John Azoman, head of a volunteer organization supporting Ukrainian army, Yudujelo, Lithuania. Yes, very quickly. When we start our activities, we have been doing that for 1 year. We provide approximately armor, body armor, helmets, boots, whatever, night vision for 200,000 euros to all kinds of units in the Ukrainian armed forces. We did that for two reasons. One, of course, that we thought this was wrong. It was definitely not. We're supposed to another kind of, we're not supposed to abuse another kind of like that. The second reason, however, was that this was different. When we go in there, we feel that there is actually an opportunity to make a difference in Ukraine. Ukraine is something else. Ukraine is a different case. And I tend to perceive the Ukrainian case, of course, with all this drama and trauma and depression, what I meet every second we're going to go there. I also meet this kind of like an opportunity. And my question is basically, how would the case of Ukraine actually could be used actually to get to Russia? Because in my opinion, in Ukraine, we have to win. We cannot stand down in Ukraine. And how are we supposed to do that? I do have some ideas to get back to that tomorrow, but for now, I ask you, how is the case in Ukraine to be applied in this context we're discussing right now? Any suggestions, ideas?
Anybody on the panel want to take that, or someone in the audience?
I just want to reject the idea we have to win in Ukraine. The Ukraine has to win.
No, we have to win. I'm sorry for that.
That is exactly Putin's narrative. He says there is a war over Ukraine when I'm fighting United States, and who will win, we will see. That's his narrative. That's I'm against. I say Ukrainians have to win their country, their freedom, their democracy, their dignity. That's what they're fighting for. We have to help them. I agree with you. But I would just avoid using we have to win. No. We have to win a better world for all of us, yes. But Ukrainians will manage their life themselves. I strongly believe in this.
We have another question or comment right in front of the...
Hi, Mark Schleifer at the Center for International Private Enterprise. Just like to follow up Chris Walker's comment, I actually don't see Chris, but he pointed out that there already are folks, including Navalny's website, that are doing a lot to bring information about corruption, kleptocracy, you know, publishing people's wristwatches and gold, diamond, jewelry, all that, bring that information back into Russia. I guess the question that I have for those of you who are thinking about these issues, to what extent does that actually move the needle in terms of public opinion in Russia? I mean, even if we increase those sources of support through independent media, websites, things of that nature, it was pointed out earlier, the contradiction here was someone else pointed out earlier that, you know, 90% of the Russian population gets its news from the state-controlled television. So, you know, how do we square that circle? At what point would all this independent information actually start to move people to do something?
Yeah, just let me repeat. What we're seeing today, it's a result of the 12 to 15 years old process. So we cannot measure our efforts or our strategies by saying what we have to do today, because answer is, of course, like the one that I quoted from the NATO meeting, that things were so far that we can do nothing. No, of course we can do something, just we cannot expect that it will come overnight. It has to be long-term strategy, long-term involvement, a large amount of resources mobilized, and strong political will. All this is lucky. And we are talking to each other about this. And you are asking me why the governments are not responding to our report, and I am asking you why you have still so little funds with the National Endowment for Democracy to do the work that you are so excellently doing since 1984. So in a sense, this is our problem, and that's why we are talking about it. And we are with great people from Russia and from outside Russia who knows media market, who knows specific circumstances and business models there. We know what to do. It takes time, but there are already strategies in place. They just need to be supported. And that has to be done by themselves. Novaya Gazeta is struggling for survival. We were just talking about here. They need maybe $300,000, $500,000 US dollars or euro support just to survive next year. Let's think about doing something for them. Let's ask companies, because we haven't touched yet the subject, that companies, international companies that are operating in Russia, they are afraid of placing advertisement in Novaya Gazeta because that may damage their business there. Volvo. And the big names like this, you know. So it's again the censorship we are talking about the publishers. They are afraid to publish books in the West. So maybe let's help them by setting up a fund where they can place a socially responsible funds that will then invest in those advertisements on their behalf without naming them. So finally, they will have deniability and the distance, and at the same time, they will save their face by doing business in Russia and still supporting independent Russian language media. There are strategies, there are solutions, but still there is no will to follow.
Well, we're almost out of time. I think we can take one or two last comments or questions if we have any people eager to have anything. No, it looks as though everybody's ready for cocktails.
I think we need to, amongst all these other things that we're thinking about, we need to not forget that this isn't the Cold War. This isn't a situation where there are Americans or Europeans behind a wall and Russians and East Europeans behind another, the other side of the wall.
300,000 Russians live in London. 3 million in Germany. So do we imagine that publishing something in Russian in Germany or in Europe would not have a huge impact? I can tell you just from my personal experience again that when my book was published in the US, within 2 weeks, I started to have postings on my Facebook page. I have 2,000 Russian friends. They mainly post cat videos. But on this occasion, within 2 weeks, they took a picture with my book in their Moscow kitchen. So we don't need to go behind the Iron Curtain. There are Russians everywhere, and believe me, if you were to publish, have a joint venture in Israel, that is a huge place where people come and go. So putting publications amongst Russians doesn't demand that you do it in Russia. Just sell stuff at Waterstone, Piccadilly, in the Russian section. It would be a really good idea.
Well, thank you for ending things. Andrei Larionov, who is always a man of the last moment. Okay, we'll take Andrei's comment and then we'll break things up. Andrei, do you have the mic?
Thank you, Charles. Just a very short comment. I think we should win this war. This is a common war. We have one enemy, and this is a victory for everybody. For Ukrainians to win against aggressor, for Europeans to win against the bureaucracy, for Americans to win their war, and for Russians to win free and democratic and peaceful country.
Thank you, Andrei. Now, before anybody even thinks about standing up, I have a very short logistical announcement to make. Thank you all for coming, first of all, and it's really wonderful to be here. And again, I love being surrounded with Lithuanians. Unfortunately, we have some Americans too here. And then we have this has been a very Lithuanian-focused thing too. We have some very distinguished Europeans from other countries, but we've kept this a very Lithuanian-focused event, and I think that's been very successful. So anyway, see you in the morning, I hope. And for those invited to the dinner, hosted by the minister, it starts at 1900, 7 p.m., at the Narutis Hotel, N-A-R-U-T-I-S, Narutis Hotel.